discuss together with Antonio a very quite challenging topic in the from both the viewpoint of academia and industrial partners. And this is true because there is a huge interest in this field. And for this reason, we will provide the 1 hour lecture, which is more or less split 50-50 between me and Antonio. And this is the outline of our talk. I will first motivate the need for analyzing cyber attacks, if this was not already obvious, but with the focus on the IoT landscape. I will then spend a few slides on what it is now considered the state of the art in data-driven design of network intrusion detection systems, and what is currently missing, what are the current limitations of these design approaches. I will then discuss the need for having decision procedures in network intrusion detection systems which can be trusted and relied on. And this will allow me to introduce the topic of explainable AI. I will then pass the stage to Antonio, who will analyze the issue of robustness and generalizability in the design of data-driven network intrusion detection system. And he will end with some tips and tricks for setting a data-driven pipeline to design network intrusion detection system with the focus on IoT. First of all, why should we care about cyber attacks and cybersecurity, and why should we even care more in the future? Because there has been a significant growth of cyber attacks incidents in the last years, with also an ever-evolving nature. This trend was already noticeable in the last years, but things have rapidly escalated with the Russian-Ukrainian war. And if you think about it, a similar disruptive discontinuity has also happened to video conferencing apps during the COVID pandemic. And in fact, from time to time, there are global scale events which affect and redefine the nature of traffic. And accordingly, the enforcement of timely and effective network security policies becomes a key requirement for companies and organizations, maybe them small or large. There is no difference. And this is reflected also in the expected cost of cybercrime on businesses, and which is projected to reach up to $10.5 trillion by next year. Okay. And the problem of network security becomes even a true challenge when facing the IoT ecosystem, because there has been a surge of connected things to the internet, with the consequent increase of the attack surface. And their application range within different verticals, which may be smart homes, heavy industry, and healthcare. So in each of these domains, there are demanding security requirements. And for this reason, there is an urgent need for tools that are capable of detecting and recognizing attacks to react timely with proper countermeasures. And accordingly, in this talk, we will discuss how to design a network intrusion detection system by performing traffic classification of attacks, which are carried out against IoT devices with both deep learning but also machine learning techniques as a comparison. This task is formally defined as an attack traffic classification task, and jointly models malicious and benign traffic as a multi-classification task. So this is, from the inference viewpoint, a classification task. And in other words, our objective is to assign to each traffic object a label among L classes, which may correspond to either benign traffic, so everything is okay, or to a specific attack. And by doing this classification, we are also trying to recognize and to identify that specific attack. Our design is based on biflow-less traffic object, which means that we are considering a biflow-based analysis. And biflows are nothing more than aggregation of packets that are sharing the same transport level protocol, source, destination IP, and ports in a double way fashion. So this means that we are taking into account requests and responses. starting point of our study is our knowledge about traffic classification, because traffic classification is a problem in which you are trying to associate traffic objects with the applications or services that are generated. And this kind of problem is well established in the context of network traffic analysis. And for this task, a lot of deep learning and machine learning techniques have been proposed in recent years. And because of this reason, we have tried to assess the performance of advanced deep learning techniques when applying these traffic classification methods to the classification of attacks targeted to IoT devices. And the objective is, first of all, to understand whether there is a case for deep learning. So it means that whether deep learning can provide a true benefit to classification of attacks in comparison to machine learning, and also design unbiased inputs for deep learning attack traffic classifier. By unbiased, I mean that the inputs are allowed to generalize. So I will discuss it later. However, there are current limitations in the design of data-driven network intrusion detection systems, and these current limitations are mainly three. The first limitation is that current network intrusion detection systems are usually designed as post-mortem. Post-mortem means that the analysis of the traffic can be performed only after the end of the byflow, so you can't declare a decision, have a decision before. During the lifetime of byflow, so you can't take early countermeasures, and also exploits only one facet of the network traffic, which is by design and by definition multifaceted and heterogeneous. The second problem is that data-driven network intrusion detection system has a decision process which is usually opaque and cannot be trusted. So when they work, we don't know why they work. Okay. The last one is that data-driven network intrusion detection systems usually lack generalizability, which means that you can design a network intrusion detection system on a certain point of the network, but you are not sure that this will work when ported to another network point. And for this reason, we would like to have a network intrusion detection system which has three important features, which means that takes decisions in a prompt fashion and capitalizes all the peculiarities of the traffic observed. It is explainable in the sense that we can attribute right or wrong decisions to specific portion of the traffic bulk that we are observing, and it is robust in the sense that we expect no significant degradation when using it on a different point of a network or an organization. Okay. The starting point for achieving this desiderata with a proper design, of course, is the analysis of single modal architectures which can detect and classify an attack based only on the early portion of the byflow that the network intrusion detection system is analyzing. And specifically in this talk, we will show the performance of two architectures that are reported in the slide. On the left, we have a 1D convolutional neural network which processes the first NB bytes of the transport layer payload. We name this kind of input pay shortly. And the second architecture on the right is a hybrid architecture, which is based on the combination of 2D convolutional layers and LSTM, which is a recurrent layer. And this architecture is named hybrid in the following, whose inputs are informative fields of the first NP packets of the header of the traffic object. Specifically, the informative fields are reported in the slide, and these are the packet length, the inter-arrival time, the direction of the packet, the TCP window size, the time to leap, and the TCP flags. To tune the input size of these two architectures, we first performed a sensitivity analysis where we show that there is, of course, a trade-off between the performance by varying NB and NP, And there is a trade-off between the recognition accuracy, which they can be measured in terms of different metrics, as you can see in the slide, and the complexity, which more or less grows almost linearly in terms of the number of trainable parameters with the input sites. For this reason, we have chosen as 576 bytes and 20 packets as the optimal point, which accommodates both the performance and complexity requirements, and allows also to accommodate prompt decision requirements that I was discussing earlier. The second observation is that the reported deep learning architectures are single model architectures and can achieve a prompt data classification, but have a performance which is far from the ideal because they exploit only phases of the traffic observed. And we know that traffic data is intrinsically multimodal because of the protocol encapsulation and the different information at different levels that are encoded in packets. And for this reason, the main asset of deep learning, of multimodal deep learning, is to exploit this multi-phase determination in order to get a hierarchical representation which exploits all the different modalities, the points, the phases of the traffic. Why we have introduced the novel proposal from our group, which is called MIMETIC. MIMETIC stands for Multi-Based Mobile Traffic Classification. This is a deep learning, multimodal deep learning architecture, which is essentially made, which can process different inputs, which are associated to different modalities. And this is done by having a structure that is reported on the left of the slide, in which you have first a number of single modality layers, which are input specific, which first try to extract informative features from each modality. Then you have a point where these features associated to different modalities are joined together. And then there are a few shared representation layers which allow to create the true shared to true multimodal representation which is associated to the traffic. Of course, the model is ended with a softmax layer which allows us to perform the classification task. This kind of architecture is trained by two phases. The first phase is reported in the right of the slide. The first phase is the pre-training, and the second phase is the fine-tuning. During the pre-training, each single modality stack is pre-trained independently, which means that there is no shared representation layer, and each modality chain is topped with a softmax layer stub. And this is to make each branch able to solve the problem alone. Okay. Then there is the fine-tuning phase where the softmax stubs are removed and the training of the whole MIMETIC architecture is performed after freezing the parameter of the lower layers. This kind of architecture was originally proposed for traffic classification, for network traffic analysis, but has been recently applied by us in the context of network intrusion detection system design. And specific implementation of MIMETIC in this case exploits two different modalities. And these two modalities are the first NP bytes of transport layer payloads and informative fields of the first NP packets. To also capture intermodality dependencies, the abstract features extracted by the single modality branches, as I was saying before, are then joined to extract more significant features. And as we'll see in the following, for this architecture, we also design a novel input type, which is named NET in this slide and in the following of the lecture, which leverages information extracted at the network layer. This proposal is compared with four machine learning-based traffic classifiers, which are considered as baselines. In detail, we consider a naive bias approach, a decision tree, a random forest, which is a state-of-art technique in machine learning, and a Bayesian classifier. And for these classifiers, we have considered 70 handcrafted Byflow-based features, which means that these are 70 and crafted features which can be calculated only after the end of buffer. So these type of baselines exploit the whole lifetime of the buffer, and so are post-mortem by definition. For our experiments, we employed the IoT23 dataset, which is publicly available, and you can download it and you can process it if you want. And this is a dataset which is collected in the Stratosphere Lab of the Technical University during 2018 and 2019. And this is a dataset which is collected in a controlled IoT network environment, where different IoT devices are used, and different type of attacks are, as you can see in the bar plot here, are performed against these IoT devices. Some pre-processing should be performed before using the dataset, because there are some classes of attacks which contain really few samples, so cannot be effectively used to design and test that specific attack. And at the end of the day, we end up with the reported number of buffers and 13 classes, which means a benign class plus 12 classes of attacks. In this slide, we first compare our experimental results obtained with machine learning baselines. I recall you that these machine learning baselines are post-mortem by design, with deep learning approaches for traffic classification. Looking at the bar plot, it is apparent that all machine learning approaches, with exception of the night bias because of the independence of the features in the statistical assumption, achieve promising results. And in particular, the two ensemble methods, which are the bagging and random forest, achieve an F measure of 77%. On the contrary, the deep learning techniques show less promising results. And this is more evident for the 1D CNN based on PAI, a little bit less for the 2D, the hybrid architecture based on PSQ. What it is really important is that using a multimodal technique allows us to improve current proposal based on deep learning. However, there is still a noticeable gap between machine learning baselines and this multimodal proposal, because this multimodal proposal is designed to be an early identifier of attacks, while the machine learning baselines are post-mortem. This phenomenon is even more evident when looking at the fine-grained performance of the three architectures, of the three deep learning architectures. And actually, the main problem with the classification performance is that the 1D CNN architecture misclassifies many instances belonging to other classes as either a part of horizontal port scan type of attack, or a generic attack, which is the attack 12. And this is because of the class imbalance problem. And also, this kind of imbalance is also shared by the hybrid architecture and also by mimetics. So this is a more general problem. The second novelty that we discuss here is the use of a third type of input for deep learning architecture, which is named NET. And then this is made of L3 header, L4 header, plus payload without biased fields. Biased fields means that we are not considering in this information, this data, the source and destination IP address, the source and destination ports, and the IP and L4 checksum, which may be biased fields. I will then discuss this aspect later. When we include this kind of input in our mimetic architecture, we are able to achieve an F measure which is roughly equal to 92%, which means that we are able to outperform machine learning baselines by designing an early identification of attacks targeting IoT devices. The significant FMH improvement of more or less 25%, which is obtained by including the net input, is further proven by comparing the two confusion matrices. So this means that on the right you have mimetic with net plus PSQ, and on the left you have the old version of mimetic without net, so using pain. So this means that there is a reduction, as you can see, as underlined, there is a reduction of the error patterns, and there is a higher concentration of the classification on the main diagonal, which means that there is a higher general write pattern in the write architecture. Reasoning on the proposed mimetic architecture, what it is really disappointing, however, is that it works quite well, but we don't actually know why. So it is of interest understanding what's going into this black box. However, understanding the internal behavior of neural networks is not only useful to interpret and justify their behavior, but also to troubleshoot and improve them. For this reason, in recent years, there has been a widespread adoption of explainable AI techniques in network traffic analysis. There are different techniques that have been proposed in the literature, and there is no general framework and lack of consensus on which is better. But however, usually postdoc techniques are those that are more used because they are appealing because they can be applied to a model that has been already trained. Okay, and this is what we are doing here. We are using a postdoc technique, which is based on perturbation-based methods. And specifically, we are considering an occlusion analysis, which is a very simple technique. So we are starting from a very simple analysis. And occlusion analysis is a type of perturbation analysis that studies the effect of occluding part of the input on the output of the neural network. So this means that you are masking some of the inputs to understand whether these inputs affect significantly the output of the neural network. And for this reason, by using this tool, we perform an occlusion analysis to shed light on the working principle of deep learning architecture, also highlighting the impact on fields that are known to introduce some bias in the results. And specifically, we evaluate the potential bias in the net star input type, which means that is the network input plus all the potentially biased fields, sorry. And with this kind of analysis, we want to investigate how the ATAFC classification performance changes when masking some of these potentially biased fields to understand whether these are actually implying some bias in the decision procedure of the network intrusion detection system. And by observing our performance change, we can also understand whether the impact of the field, of the potentially biased field, is minor or major. Okay. By looking at the source and destination ID, IP addresses, it is apparent that when I mask the source IP, or I mask the destination IP, or even I mask both, there is a significant drop of the performance. And this is explained because usually, when these public data that are collected, the attack is usually performed from the same machine. So it means that the same machine with the same IP address is always used to generate all different samples of the attack. So whenever you train a deep neural network or a machine learning model in general based on this type of dataset, and you are not careful about excluding the IP address, the model will recognize the attack, but not because it has understood, it has learned the specific pattern of the attack, but only because it is identifying the specific IP address. And this is true for both source IP address, but also destination IP address in our case, because we are focusing on Belarus. So this means that we are analyzing the traffic in both directions. So when this is applied to upstream packets, we are observing the same effect. The second observation is that when we occlude source and destination ports, we have a variable performance, because the source force, as we know, has less impact on the results, because the source force usually assume distinct values, and also it is almost random. Different if destination port has higher impact on results, because we know that destination port is associated to known services, so the destination port may be used to identify the attack, because some attacks are using some ports more frequently than the others. Okay. In any case, excluding both the source and destination ports leads to a significant performance drop in also that case. Finally, occluding all these fields, we have that starting from an almost ideal performance, which is reported in the bar on occlusion, we end up with 16 F-measured performance, which means that whenever you want to use data-driven techniques, you want to design a data-driven technique for network intrusion detection, and you want to design a network intrusion detection system, you should be careful on which input you want to include in your neural network or machine learning technique in general. And this is the second problem that we faced when designing network intrusion detection system. The third problem is related to robustness, which means that we are also facing some problems when the same model is applied to different network points, and this will be covered by Antonio in the second part of the talk. So I'm now stopping the sharing.
Yeah, thank you Domenico for your presentation. Now I will share my screen. Okay. Can you see it? Okay. So now I will introduce another topic related to the evaluation of network intrusion detection system, and this topic is specifically related to another desideratum that, together with the effectiveness and explainability that Domenico has talked about before, allow us to have a whole performance figure about the performance of a network intrusion detection system. Specifically, we evaluate the robustness of this type of system in terms of their generalization capabilities. Which are the generalization capabilities? These type of capabilities are the possibilities of a network intrusion detection system to be able to detect attacks that it has not seen during the training phase. So basically, we have a deep learning architecture that is used to design a network intrusion detection system that is trained on certain traffic that is collected in a network of a certain organization, and then it is tested in an operational network on other malicious traffic, so on traffic collected, for example, from another organization that is basically has not been seen during the training phase. This type of evaluation is unfortunately not so common in the state of the art performing and designing this type of systems, but it is the most common type of scenario that we found in a real network setting. To perform such an analysis, we have defined a number of cross-evaluation contexts. A cross-evaluation context is a context in which we evaluate our network intrusion detection system, and the three contexts that we have defined are summarized in this slide. The first context that we have called the baseline context is the most common one in state of the art, in which both the benign and malicious traffic is collected into the same network infrastructure. So we train and test our deep learning-based network intrusion detection system on the traffic collected in the same infrastructure. So the training infrastructure and the operational one is the same. The second context is the generalization context, in which we effectively evaluate the robustness and so the generalization capability of our network intrusion detection system, since we train it on the traffic collected in a certain network infrastructure, and then we test it, so we operate it in a network on malicious traffic that it has not seen completely during the training phase. So we would like to evaluate its robustness in handling and detecting unseen malicious traffic. Finally, the extension context is a context in which we try to mitigate the loss of the expected loss of performance that we have in a generalization context by adding knowledge during the training phase of our network intrusion detection system. Basically, we take some traffic from the operational network and then add it to the training traffic of the network intrusion detection system. Basically, we augment the knowledge that is exploited during the training phase, trying to improve the performance of the detection. To show the results of this type of cross-evaluation procedure, we have used the current deep learning-based network shown in this slide, basically a monodimensional convolutional neural network, a recurrent neural network, and a multimodal network that are basically that Domenico have explained before with input types. For emulating the cross context, we need different networks. In other terms, we need different datasets. And basically, in this case, we use three different datasets to perform such an analysis. Two datasets are IoT-related datasets that are the IoT23 that Domenico has introduced before, and the Kitsune dataset. The Kitsune dataset is another dataset that collects the traffic of attacks against IoT devices, basically against IoT surveillance cameras. It encompasses a number of different attacks like man in the middle, the distributed denial of service, attacks from and so on. But also we use a baseline dataset, which is called IDS 2018, which is a non-IoT traffic dataset. In this case, we use this dataset, which is basically collected using virtual machine in a campus that has been deployed using Amazon Web Services. Some machines act as attackers and others as victims. Use this dataset to check the generalization capability, so the robustness of our network intrusion detecting non-IoT traffic when it has been trained on IoT traffic. So to check also the differences between this type of data, of traffic data. In the right part of the slide, I have reported the composition of the three datasets in terms of number of banned and malicious byflows. I would like to stress that in this case, we have performed a binary classification, so an effectively misused detection, in which we try to understand if a certain byflow is a banning, so a legitimate byflow, or it is a malicious byflow, so it comes from an attack. The first results that I show in these slides are related to the baseline context. So the results of the baseline context are basically our upper bound. Since in this case, we have that both the training and are performed on the same dataset. So we have training and test on IoT, training and test on IDS, and training and test on Kitsune. We can notice that in all the cases, the mimetic framework, which is shown by this purple bar, is the best performing approach. With unexpected results, since mimetic, as we have seen before, is able to capitalize on the heterogeneity of traffic via its multimodal nature, and so in all the cases, is able to outperform the other two, the other two single modal approaches. In the IDS 2018 dataset, also the convolutional neural network and the recurrent neural network perform quite well. On the other hand, in the case of IoT datasets, and specifically on IoT 23, Mimetic is able to significantly outperform the other two approaches. And finally, overall, the recurrent neural network is the worst performing approaches, since in this case, the input with which it has been fed, that are basically the features of the first packets of each byte, are not so discriminative for this. So, since as we have seen in the baseline context, at least with Mimetic, we are able to obtain very good detection performance. The question that we would like to answer now is, do we still achieve good performance when we would like to detect attacks from another network, from another organization? So, is our network intrusion detection system robust enough? So we move toward the so-called generalization context. Just to recall, the generalization context is the hardest context in which we would like to detect malicious traffic that has not been seen during the training phase. So completely unknown, completely novel malicious traffic. We emulate this context by taking the two datasets, the A and the B, and we constructed the training set by taking the malicious embedding by flows from DA, while the test set contains malicious by flows from DA, embedding by flows from DA, but malicious by flows from DB. So in the test set, we have malicious traffic that we have not seen during the training. The use case is the one of an organization that, for example, has acquired a network intrusion detection system that has been trained with the traffic collected in another network and would operate this acquired network intrusion detection system on its network to detect its own malicious traffic. The results are shown as an heat map in which on the rows we have the different approaches. And we have two different x-axis, so different columns. In the upper part, we have the dataset on which we have trained the different approaches. And in the bottom part, we have the composition of the test set in terms of banning with the B letter and malicious with the M letter traffic. Results show that when we train the approaches, with the exception of the recurrent neural network that overall has not so good performance, but when we consider the convolutional neural network, but also the mimetic architecture trained on the IoT 23 dataset, we can obtain quite good performance when testing on both the malicious traffic of non-IoT traffic and the other, the Kitsune IoT traffic. So when training on IoT 23, we have a drop in performance, but our approaches, and particularly Mimetic, are quite robust. The problem is when we train all the approaches on the non-IoT traffic and we test them on the malicious traffic of IoT 23. In this case, we have a significant drop in performance down to 23%. That is far lower than the baseline of the 50%. That is a completely random guessing. So we have a performance that is lower than a random guessing. So in this case, our network intrusion detection system is not robust at all. Finally, we can notice that between brackets, we have reported also the variability of performance, since these results has been obtained by via different repetition with a random shuffling of the benign and malicious part of the datasets. We can notice that this high performance is mainly due to the different compositions of the training and test set we consider we have obtained in the repetition. So depending on which traffic has constructed the different training and test sets, we have obtained significantly different performance. And this is particularly affects the performance in this generalization context with a significant drop. So now we would like to answer to the question, can we improve the performance by adding knowledge? So when we move toward an extension context by adding knowledge during training, are we able to raise again the performance to approach toward the performance of a baseline context? So we consider the context in which we add, during the training phase of the network intrusion detection system, malicious traffic collected from the network, so from the network on which the system is tested. Eight. So to construct such context, we consider two datasets, DA and DB, and the training set is constructed by taking into account the benign byflows of DA and the malicious byflows of both DA and DB. So we add to the malicious byflows of the first dataset the ones from the second dataset. On the other hand, the test set contains benign byflows of DA, as in the generalization context, malicious byflows of only DB. So we would like to get only the malicious traffic, of course, of the operational network, of the tested network. The use case is the one of an organization that has acquired a network intrusion detection system and has noted poor generalization performance. So the needs is not robust in the operational network. And so collect some malicious traffic from the operational network and add it to the network intrusion detection system to improve its performance. In this case, we again show the performance via an heat map, but in this case, as we can notice, we have relative performance, since the performance difference with respect to the generalization context. The first thing that we can notice is that in all the cases, we have positive numbers. Positive numbers being an improvement. So we have better performance with respect generalization context. This variation goes from a plus 3% up to plus 76%. So a significant improvement in performance by adding knowledge. In particular, this improvement in performance is shown when we add to the non-IoT traffic the malicious traffic from IoT devices. So in this middle part, that I recall in the generalization context showed the worst performance. Indeed, in this case, we can obtain a significant improvement, which is up to 76% with IoT 23. I recall that in the generalization context, we drop in performance down to 23%, more or less F measure. So in this case, we have a significant raise again of the performance by adding knowledge. Finally, the architecture that benefits more from this augmented knowledge is mimetic. So when in mimetic we had some knowledge from the malicious byflows of the operational network, we approach again to the upper bound performance of the baseline. The final take-home message that expressed is the fact that overall we cannot assume that a network intrusion detection system is robust. We cannot assume it particularly when we train and test with the classic procedure. So we train it on a data set and we test it on a completely different data set. But we need some augmented knowledge coming from the operational network to improve, to augment, to raise again the performance in detection of malicious traffic overall. So to making our classifier, our intrusion detection robust. Okay, now I jump to another, to some hints on how we can implement such approaches. Basically, in these slides, I've reported in the upper bound the workflow of construction of a dataset for training a network intrusion detection system and then to operate it. Basically, we have different phases that now we will consider in more details. In particular, I will show you some Python snippets that can be used to implement them. Particularly in the bottom part, I have also reported the different phases that can be followed to construct a dataset to train and test such network intrusion detection systems. Basically, the first part involves always the collection of traffic, the collection of traffic that can be performed in an automatic or in manual way. Particularly, if the collection of traffic is performed in a manual way, so it is traffic which is human generated, in this case, we have a more realistic profile of traffic. Also, if it is collected in a laboratory. Then we have to pre-process this traffic. Basically, the pre-processing involves two different phases. The segmentation of the traffic in traffic objects, like for example, the bidirectional flow, the biflows that Domenico has explained before, and then the labeling of this traffic. The labeling is the process of associating to which biflows the application, the network attack, the type of traffic that is generated it. So for example, we would like to say if a traffic object is legitimate, is banning, or if it is malicious. After the labeling, we extract the final dataset that is used to train and test. For example, also in a cross-evaluation procedure, our network intrusion detection system. So the first phase that I would like to show you how to implement is the traffic segmentation part. Specifically, the main library that we use to implement, to manipulate traffic in Python is the SCAPI, the SCAPI library, of which I reported also the link for who is interested in using it. SCAPI library provides a number of utilities to parse and elaborate traffic traces in Python. Particularly, this object, whose name is the pickup reader, allows you to iterate over the packets contained in a pickup trace and parse them packets by packets. For example, in this case, we have used a for loop to iterate over the pickup reader, and we have accessed to each layer of a packet by using a number of macros like the or UDP provided by SCAPI that allows to access the different layer ISO OSI or in the TCP IP stack of each packet. Specifically, in this snippet, I have reported how to extract the five tuple that allows to collect the packets within a biflow. Specifically, with these instructions, so we are able to extract the source IP, the destination IP, the source port, the destination port, and the transport packet, and then group them by the quintuple and also the quintuple in the other direction, since we know that by flow the traffic both in upstream and downstream direction. And this collection is performed by storing them in a Python dictionary, in which all the packets that shares the five tuple or the five tuple in the other direction, the so-called inverse five tuple, are collected within the same list. So in this case, we effectively group all the packets sharing the five tuple list. So we are constructing the byflows. The second part I'd like to show you is how to use Python libraries to design, to implement a deep learning architecture. So to effectively implement the architecture, the model that will perform the intrusion detection. In this case, we exploit the Keras library, which is a state-of-the-art library for the definition, training, and testing of deep learning architecture. It is a wrapper of TensorFlow that allows to hide a number of difficulties of TensorFlow, which is a lower layer library, can be used to construct effectively the different parts of a deep learning architecture. First of all, just for completeness, I have reported a snippet of code that allows starting from a dataset that encompasses the samples that are, for example, the byflows of traffic data, and the labels, which can be, for example, the malicious versus the benign label. And we have used in test split to split the data set effectively into the training set, training the classifier, and the test set using to test it. The main parameter that must be set in this case is the dimension of the training set and the test set. For example, in this case, I have set a test size of 0.3, which means that we use from the overall data set the 30% for testing and the remaining part, so the 17% for training. Then, in the second part of this snippet, I just show you how we can leverage the Keras library, and particularly the Keras functional API, to design a 1D CNN, like the one that Domenico has shown before, that, for convenience, I have reported in the right part of the slide. As you can see, Keras allows to construct an architecture, like, for example, the CNN, layer by layer. So basically, you can notice that we have an initial input layer, which is called input CNN. It takes only the input shape. The input shape is the dimension of each sample in our dataset. And basically, then the first layer, which is the yellow one shown in this slide, is connected with the second layer, which is the red one, which is a convolutional layer, with this notation. We define a conv1D layer, which is obtained from the Keras library, as you can see in the upper part of the slide. We set the parameters of the 1D CNN layer, and then with this in right part, we connect it to the input layer, and then we connect the different layers in the same way. So we connect to the first convolutional layer a max pooling layer, which is the green one. To the max pooling layer, we connect another convolutional layer, again with this notation. And finally, we obtain the model, which is defined in the last line of this snippet, in which we have only to define which first layer of the model, which is the input CNN, the last layer of is the output CNN, and its name. I would like just to pose your attention on the last layer. The last layer commonly is always a dense layer, which is a number of nodes, a number of neurons, which are equal to the number of classes. In, for example, in the case of a binary classification, malicious versus benign traffic, we have two neurons, and then as activation it has a softmax. The softmax basically is a classifier which classifies which gives as up as output the class with the highest probability. So in this case, we the last layer we effectively perform the plus or, for example, the detection task. Another important part is formed by the last two lines, which allows to define the function, the loss function that should be minimized by our deep learning architecture to optimize its weights. And in this case, we have set the common categorical cross entropy, or we can also use the binary cross entropy, for example, for a binary classification task. And then the optimizer, which is the algorithm to perform this minimization task, that in this case is set as the ADAM optimizer. Perhaps allows you to use a different types of algorithms, different types of optimizers that should that can be used, can be tried to perform your minimization objective. Finally, and I conclude, the last part that I would like to show is how to perform the evaluation of the performance of this deep learning architecture. Basically, in this case, we use, in addition to the Keras library, also the Scikit-learn library that implements a number of metrics to evaluate the performance of a deep learning architecture. First of all, the deep learning architectures that we have defined and configured before must be trained. The train is performed via the fit function that is called on the model that we have defined before. Basically, the fit needs four different parameters that are the samples training set, the labels of the training set, and then the number of epochs and the batch size. The number of epochs is the number of, since the training of a deep learning architecture is performed in an iterative fashion, the number of epochs is the number of loops, the number of paths on the whole training data set that are performed to complete the whole training procedure. The batch size is set since the minimization process is performed by using a mini batch based stochastic gradient descent procedure. And so in this case, since we do not try to found the global optimum of our function to be minimized, which is the categorical cross entropy as shown before, we perform such optimization in an heuristic fashion by setting a batch size, which is a reduced set of our overall dataset. After defined these four parameters, we can train our architecture that after a certain time that can go from seconds to days, depending basically on the complexity of the architecture and of the complexity of the training set itself, we can evaluate its performance. Its performance can be are evaluated by calling the predict function on the model again. In this case, this model is different from this model since after the fit, this model has been trained. So its weights, its internal weights are changed. And so in this case, we can predict its performance on the samples of the test set. When we call the predict, we obtain for each sample of the test set a vector, an array with a confidence value. The highest confidence value, the highest probability is the one associated with actual classification. How we can obtain this actual classification? By extracting the maximum of this vector, of this array. So we take the which is in correspondence to the high probability, which is actually the response of our classifier. So for example, the response could be, is this by flow malicious or benign? It is more probable the malicious part or the benign part, depending on which is the highest probability, we can give our final response. And then finally, to evaluate the performance of defined deep learning model, we exploit scikit-learn functions. Learn functions allows us to use different performance metrics like the accuracy, the F-measure, but also more fine-grained ones like confusion matrices. And basically, when we calculate these metrics, we compare the responses of the classifier, so the prediction test, this one, with the ground truth. So we compare the actual classes with the predict. If the response are the same, our classifier gives a correct prediction, otherwise gives a wrong prediction. So we can evaluate the performance via different metrics. Both arithmetically averaged, like in the case of the macro F measure, but also by using some more fine-grained report by providing the per-class performance. If we are not satisfied by these summary metrics, we can also, again by using the scikit-learn library, compute plot the confusion matrices that provide the fine-grained performance by class, by also showing the misclassification errors that the classifiers has made. So in this case, we can drill down in the specific performance of the classifier, and specifically, we can check how the classifier makes error. So, to conclude, we have trained, tested, and basically designed a number of network intrusion detection system by using different state-of-the-art deep learning traffic classifiers and using them to perform attack traffic classification. Basically, we have seen different aspects in terms of effectiveness, in terms of trustworthiness, and in terms of robustness. And firstly, we have seen that when using the same input types that are effective in the case of encrypted traffic classification, in the case of attack traffic classification, so in a completely different, so in the security domain, we are not able to obtain the same good performance. So we need to design a proper input type, like for example the net input that Domenico has described, has shown, to obtain satisfactory performance also when performed detection. Then we have also performed an explainability analysis by an occlusion analysis that some fields could wrongly inflate performance, so introduce bias in. And so we should avoid using these fields when performing when designing a network intrusion detection system. And finally, I have shown how we can evaluate the performance, the robustness in terms of generalization performance by defining different cross-evaluation contexts. And in particular, we have seen that in most of the cases, the generalization performance of network intrusion detection system is taken for granted, but we need to augment their knowledge to obtain a good adaptation in a new context. Particularly, we have to add information, some knowledge from the operational context into of the network intrusion detection system to obtain good performance also different operational network. This is the essential bibliography of the content that we have shown in this lecture. In blue are reported the papers that our research group has have published in these years, And this concludes our presentation. Thanks a lot for your attention. If you have any question, feel free to ask it. Thank you again.